Welcome, everyone. So good to see you. Wonderful friends, colleagues, associates across the university. This is just a great day to welcome you all here. As we're settling in, we're going to invite you to take a look at this slide and think about the question of when you imagine or remember what it's like to work with student teams from the instructional point of view, which of these images seems to capture your experience best? So be thinking of which one, and momentarily, Melissa will give us a Zoom poll, and we're gonna ask you to put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 in the Zoom poll, but then use chat to describe a little bit about why you chose that. So welcome, if you're just joining us, come on in. Great to see you here. We look forward to engaging with you. As I just mentioned, take a look at this slide and respond to the Zoom poll about which of these images seems to you to represent your experience from an instructional point of view of working with student teams. So go ahead and respond to the poll, and you can also be putting into the chat, why did you choose what you chose? So welcome everyone as you're continuing to join. I see that our group is still gathering. So as you come in, choose a number of what image represents for you, what it's like from the instructor's point of view to work with student teams. And put a vote in the Zoom poll, and in the chat, you can start to describe why. Why have you chosen that particular image? So let's see if we've got some folks coming up here. We've got, okay. Josh is thinking like teams as experiments. Okay. Kate is thinking orchestra because it's about both, everyone has roles and responsibilities. The cello isn't playing the clarinetist part. We've got Bubbling Brook, constantly in motion. Great. Dan is the directing energy and flow. And Kelly, it's experimental again. Yes. And also there's an oil and water theme going on here. This is terrific. Keep them coming. Yeah. Let's see. Yes, yes. Okay, maybe one more minute for folks to put a final vote in the poll and share a reason why.
I really love Julie's note of looks like 4, feels like 3.
Yeah, I'm really interested, like those who choose the 3, like what for me, the wild ride, and then you know the perpetual, you know, herding cats, and Doug is saying watching a conductor friend when I was struggling with leadership styles and appreciated his light touch. That's great. Well, thank you so much for look, can we see the results of the poll? Let's Oh, wow, okay. And a pretty even distribution. I'm intrigued. Okay. But the laboratory kind of experiment, mixing, alchemy, that's our highest, but you know, with close seconds with several 18%. So, all right, that's terrific. Thank you. Well, we are in for a treat today. And I wanted to say a word about what's in store. As we've seen from this icebreaker, team projects can build and bring about great things, but they're also very complicated and can be challenging to manage and to engage in. And so in this session, we're going to pull back the curtain on 3 courses that have figured out some really important ways to engage students productively, effectively, and powerfully in team projects. So we're going to hear about the secret sauce, a little bit of how they do it, why they do it, what kind of roadblocks have they faced, and how have they worked those through. and allow you then to ask them some questions. So you have their bios from the HILT pages, and I think HILT will also put links again into the chat. So I'm not going to at length describe our wonderful panelists. Just going to name them and thank them for being here. First of all, Karina Lin-Murphy from DCE, my collaborator in putting this together. And then from Harvard Kennedy School, Matt Andrews, the Edward S. Mason Senior Lecturer in International Development, and Salima Samji, Director of Building State Capability. And from the Harvard Graduate School of Education, Carrie Conaway, Senior Lecturer on Education, thank you. And from the Harvard Chan School of Public Health, Jocelyn Chu, Director of Community Engaged Learning and Instructor. So lots of different disciplinary perspectives, lots of concrete practices that they are set to share. What we'll invite you to do as we move through the session is to go ahead and put in the chat questions that occur to you. Karina and I will be looking at them and culling and curating them for the Q&A that we'll have in the latter part of the session. The other reminder is just that this session is being recorded, and so to be mindful of that as well. So I think with that, unless I'm forgetting anything, Karina, I think we are ready to start. Yes? Okay, great. So what we're first going to do is have each of the three courses take 2 minutes, a lightning round, to just show us how they use Teams very concretely. And then we'll get into some more extensive and substantive kinds of probing questions. So first from Matt and Salima, take it away.
Great, thank you so much. I think I'm just gonna lead off. We have 2 minutes, so Salima's voice will come in a little bit later. The course we're gonna describe is a course that we run as a module in the spring. And it's a course where we usually have somewhere between 30 and 50 students. And the students do a fieldwork course, but in residence. So they don't go out into the field, but they work with people who are in the field. And we essentially put teams together. And one of the goals is just that the teams learn how to work as teams. Everything we do is applied. All of the work is applied. And we're trying to prepare people to be able to work in the field, to be able to work in an organization dealing with complex challenges. So essentially, learning how to work as a team is itself a goal. It's not just a vehicle, right? So we want them to work in groups of teams of 4 to 6. They can move between teams for a limited time at the beginning, but essentially, you know, we don't pay a huge amount of attention to who gets into which team, because we don't theoretically, empirically think that that matters very well. We think it matters a lot more. How do they structure how they work together, and what does the actual working together look like? So a lot of times people will spend a lot of time thinking about who is working together. We don't think that matters. It matters, you know, what do you do once they're working together, and how do you get them to work together? They work together in class, and they work with a client. We actually use the class time for their team meetings. We found that one of the things that is tricky is finding time for people to work together. So we just help that. And one session a week, they work with Salima and I as kind of coaches. And we talk about what they were meant to do, what their homework was. And the other session a week, they actually just work together without any of us present, just by themselves. So they are outside of this also engaging with the client. And then they're also doing individual independent work outside of this, which they bring back into the teamwork. We have a simple approach that they use to engage in the teamwork, where when they get together, they say, what did you do? What did you learn? What are you struggling with? What's next? So that all of them get a chance to talk, all of them get a chance to work. And their goal is that they bring their work together to create something that is bigger than what they can do on their own, and to learn how to do that.
Wonderful. Thank you, Matt. And we'll hear more from Salima shortly. Carrie, introduce us to the world of Evidence 101 and Teams.
Yes. Hi, everyone. Thank you for including me in the conversation today. I'm here to talk about the Evidence 101 course. And you've got some details on the slide, but the two big things that I think are important for understanding the context here, one is that this course is part of a new foundational curriculum at the Graduate School of Education. So all 650 of our master's students need to take this course. And it's a massive effort. We have 18 faculty, 51 people on the teaching team, teaching in groups of 65 or so. So it's required. It takes place in the summer over the course of 8 days. And it's a full 4-credit course. And it is pass-fail. All of our foundational courses are pass-fail. So our goal with all of these courses is that we're helping to professionalize the field of education. We're trying to define a common body of knowledge that students should know and build skills that they'll need as education professionals, one of which is working in a team. And so the way we've designed the course gives them a chance to practice, but also a chance for us to model, which I'll probably talk about a little bit later. We team teach the course. So the faculty are in a team and the students are in a team. We use an adaptation of the Michelson and Sweet formal team-based learning model. I put a site on the slide if you're interested in learning more about it. But the gist of it is that students prepare on their own using videos and readings and things like that. They take a quiz on their own before they come to class. When they come into class, the first thing we do is we take that same quiz again as a team. So students can either try to say why they think their answer is right, or maybe they learn from somebody else why their answer was incorrect and they retake as a team. And then in the second half of class, we apply that learning to a real educational challenge related to that content. And then they also do a final project that also is team-based. So it's a really exciting and fun class. And I think we've had some real great luck with working in teams. I'm happy to share more about it.
Wonderful. Thank you, Carrie. Jocelyn.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I'm here to talk and share a little bit about DRPH 250, which is a course that I co-teach with Peja Stojtic, who couldn't be here. He's at another conference. But thinking about teams, it really wouldn't do it justice without acknowledging that there is a huge instructional team that have either come before us or with us, Peja, Michelle Morse, Fawn Phelps, and our great team of teaching assistants. So just wanted to acknowledge that the ideas and does not reside in one person. With regard to this course, it is designed for a leadership degree in the School of Public Health. In terms of the number of students, it's much, much smaller than the other two colleagues, the other courses in the panel. This is really a cohort of 10 students that come into the Doctor of Public Health program. It sits within a sequence of classes that start in the summer of their first year, thinking about their own self and personal mastery. So just a little bit of background. The student teams learn this practice of creating and leading what we're calling interdependent teams. And the class brings the students through this process as they're developing and testing these conditions. And they're also preparing to work on a project with an external host organization or a client, as the Kennedy School colleagues mentioned. The way that the teams are set up is that it is a self-facilitated process where the instructors leave the room and have the students make decisions on their own. And that's kind of going to be a little bit of that secret sauce that I'll talk about later on. However, we don't just throw them in the room and leave them there. There is a facilitated process and guidance and scaffolding that goes around, but that they do review the proposals that come to us. And then there is a process of a meeting with each of the host organizations, learning not only about the project, but also leadership styles of those host organizations. In terms of what they do together, I thought, in my mind at least, I thought about sort of splitting it up into what we think about as like the technical work that the students engage in, but also the adaptive work of the interpersonal work around actually operationalizing interdependence. There are these class exercises around really creating a team purpose, shared agreements and roles and responsibilities, but as they finalize this work plan, which then they will implement in the winter term or the J term. So just other notes that I guess we'll go into a little bit later on is this idea around intention setting and a reflective reflections on that process of teaming and launching the team. More of that later.
Thank you. Thank you so much, all of you. So we've seen a range of courses, one of which where teams per se, working in teams is the core content. One where working in teams is a main way to assess students' work, and one where teams is a way of doing work in the world. And so let's dig a little deeper now and hear some more about some of our big idea questions about why use teams, what do students like and not like, how do you deal with challenges? So let's first hear, why do you use teams? Like what is it about teams that makes doing what you're trying to do in the course kind of impossible to do without?
So, you know, our course, the actual focus of our course is for them to actually, you know, make change in the world. So it didn't start off as, you know, we want you to learn how to be in a team. But at the Building State Capability Program, we work with people all over the world trying to make change in areas where they haven't made change before. So our kind of research agenda is to try to understand, how do you penetrate complexity? How do you penetrate complex challenges that have been prohibitively opaque, inaccessible, difficult to change, where the politics is really bad, et cetera. And what we found over time is that, you know, one of the reasons why people don't get into those areas is because they're tremendously risky, because they need to learn, because they don't know what they're doing. So over time in the field, what we kind of learned is, firstly, you need to have multiple people working together so that they can share ideas, so that they can learn from each other. Also, so that they can share risk with each other. And so we started in the field working with teams, and we recognized that actually you don't deal with complex challenges by having a champion and by having individuals who are smart as hell, developing a great plan and putting that in place. You essentially develop a team that can go into a really risky environment and do risky things and adapt together and learn together. And so we found that teaching that in the classroom requires the same, right? Is that you can't say to our students, well, the way in which you actually help people learn, you know, we've learned how to put them in school. We don't know how to get them to learn. The way in which you do that work is by sitting in an office by yourself and thinking big thoughts and, you know, running algorithms on your computer. No, it's by bringing people together who have different backgrounds, who don't work together tremendously well, and developing this very, very interesting organizational mechanism, which is called a team. And the team is a space where people talk to each other, they engage with each other, they're honest, they love each other, they fight with each other, they do all of these things together, and they move together. And so, you know, we find that it's invaluable, because if you want to teach how to engage in this world, I think you have to get people to engage in the way that you need to engage in the world. We also find that kind of learning works in this way too, is that we have a way of being able to impart ideas through, you know, we flip our classrooms and we can, you know, have a video of ourselves saying, this is what we're trying to teach you this week, right? Now we want you to do an assignment by yourself. Now we want you to take that assignment into your team. And now we want your team to talk about the assignment and develop a team assignment. And then we go one step further, where we say, now we want you to go and speak to somebody who's not in the team and ask them about your assignment. So our approach is very much about, how do you interact with yourself, how do you interact with other people in a very thick way, and then how do you interact with others so that you can learn? And we find that the team process is just gigantically important. It's invaluable. It cannot be done outside of this, or else what you have is you have us passively engaging with them and then passively engaging back to us, and you don't have the chewing, you don't have the interaction, you don't have the challenge, you don't have all of the coming back and thinking, hey, but you know, professor, my friend said this, my friend said that, we spoke to those people. So it really is where we've come to is, it's not just the vehicle for teaching. It is absolutely central to the demonstration of how to do this work, but also it allows us for this kind of complete approach to teaching, where we can throw an idea in, have them think about it independently, have them share it, have them engage, have them constantly come back to each other.
And if I could just add, from this morning's panel, Bharat said team formation doesn't equal learning. And exactly. So we know that it's not just teamwork is needed, but you don't just say, voila, you're a team and they're going to work together. There is things that we're going to do. And in the question that I will answer, I will tell you what we do, what's our secret sauce in making that work.
Fabulous. And I'm hoping that in that further elaboration, I guess as I hear you, Matt, it strikes me that what students are doing is learning then to be able to form and support and be in teams when the course is no longer around and they're working with people who've never heard of this approach. So
that's exactly right. And the person, we have them work with the client, but the client has been through a course like this with us. So they understand this too. So yes, so what we're hoping is that they then can become the person who goes out. And then what we have is we have a community of practice where people who've been through these courses join the community of practice after the fact. And this is kind of the way in which beyond, you know, teams that we want our methodology, which is a specific methodology of working, is kind of transferred in the world, where we think that it's through people and it's through our students. And our opportunity is not just to impart knowledge. Our opportunity is to impart knowledge and have people then take the knowledge to everybody else. And we take that very seriously. And teams are part of that process.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you. Well, Carrie, You've been teaching evidence now for a few years, and this year for the first time at full scale. With this team-based learning approach as adapted for evidence, what are the things that students really loved and are loving, and what are they liking not so much?
Excuse me. You know, when I'm relatively new to teaching. I've been on the faculty for, I think I'm starting my fourth year. And I came in an avowed group project hater. I was somebody who was always the student who got stuck doing the whole thing themselves at the end and feeling like the whole work rode on my effort and everybody else was free riding on my effort. And so I came in super skeptical about this approach, but I have to say that I am convinced that this is the right way to teach this material. What I didn't say is like what this class is actually about is about using different forms of evidence in order to evaluate and learning how to evaluate evidence and apply it in education contexts. And what I think we have done well here is design the teamwork where we get a lot of the benefits of teams and very few of the downsides. The teamwork is low stakes for their grade. Remember, it's a pass-fail class. And so we mainly are looking that they're participating. We're not looking at the like a score, a grade, or something like that on the assessments. And so you don't have to worry about somebody else shirking. It's not going to affect your grade. And our final project is very scaffolded through the course. So I mentioned those daily activities. Each one of them in some way they will use in the final project. It's not like this whole separate thing that people have to go out and research. It's contained with the readings of the class. It's contained with the work they do in class. And so they can put aside all those worries and just focus on the content. And I'm really pleased with how well this has actually worked with students. We do, I mean, it is a course on evidence. And so we would be doing a disservice if we did not collect evidence on our course about evidence. So we do daily exit tickets, we do course evaluations, and rarely do students say anything about the team as being, the team aspect as being a negative in this course. When they do, there's, as with anything like this, there's gonna be a handful of teams that things just don't gel for whatever reason. So that's usually to the extent somebody raises that they essentially feel like they didn't get a great team placement. But guess what? It's over in 8 days. Like, you're not stuck with this person for the rest of the semester. And we have had a couple divorces for various reasons. We just manage those as need be. It's rare. And it does feel like they're getting all that benefit without a lot of those downsides. So that's what I think students like the most.
Terrific. Wow. Okay. Jocelyn, so what are some of the main challenges you face with your approach to an engagement with teams in your course about teams? And how have you responded to those, some of those big challenges?
Yeah, this question really resonated with me because it has been definitely challenging in terms of not only working with students, but also in teams, but also teaming with the host organization or the client, if you will. So it's there are a lot of unknowns when working with host organizations. In public health practice, there's a risk on both ends with our students doing this work, but also for the host to bring in a team of students. And one example is when there was a year where we actually had the Boston Public Health Commission host all of our students. And that's when also when COVID hit, and we were definitely sidelined with certain teams that were working, especially one that was working with the Division of Emergency Preparedness. So in all that's to say is that although challenges are actually, I was thinking this morning how there are opportunities to sharpen our focus and to iterate this work forward. I think in terms of, so given that it's really sort of this selection of hosts or bringing hosts that what we've learned is maybe leaner organizations, more nimble to be able to pivot, that we have a little bit more control and over the scope of work. So that's just a learning, and it may not always be the case, but I think where we've iterated to is smaller organizations where there's that is not such huge systems. And also, I think also another challenge has been right-sizing the project. So the class itself is an 8-week class on teaming. And then it's supposed to then launch them into this work that's only, it's for 3 weeks in the January term. What we have been trying to figure out is how do you right size it so that for a group of graduate students, and these are seasoned professionals, we're edging towards what we're calling a mid-career cohort of students. So it can't be so prescriptive. But it has to have a little bit of wiggle room for the students themselves, that team to help to a little bit abstract so that they can sink their teeth into it and sort of shape the scope of work with that organization in order through conversations. So that's really also that teaming process, not only within the student team, but also teaming with the host organization. I think that host organizations, in terms of working with them, that they're also amenable to, that this is a learning experience for the students as well. So in terms of the projects, they're sort of projects of strategic significance, but they've been on the back burner. They're not gonna make or break your organization. They don't have sort of this imminent deadline necessarily, but it is to bring a group of thought partners along with the team that they're working with. So in terms of the challenges, it has been sort of that right-sizing the scope, selection of host organizations. I have more, but I think we can
given us a lot to chew on already, for sure. And your comments make me mindful of just thinking about the developmental stages of students, thinking about the length of time we have in the course. Evidence is just a handful of days. I think the PDA course is a full semester. Is that true? Yeah. And then yours is a module. What level of background preparation do they already have, and how ready are they to deal with some ambiguity versus how tightly scoped and defined and scaffolded do they need the work that they do in teams to be? So really important variables that I think we're coming into as we talk further. Well, I see some great questions are starting to come into the chat, and keep them coming. As you're thinking, audience, about the questions you want to be raising for our open Q&A shortly, let's now hear an additional round about this question of 1 to 2 small practices that you implement with teams that make a big difference. So it's kind of like James Lang's idea of small teaching. These sort of things, it kind of comes down to the devil's in the details. And the way we put it is, in other words, what's your secret sauce? So Drum roll, please. Salima, now, yes, please talk with us about the secret sauce in your course.
Great. Thank you, Allison. So, you know, Amy Edmondson, who's the one who came up with, she coined the word psychological safety. She has an amazing 2x2 matrix where she has psychological safety on one axis and accountability on another axis. And she calls the learning zone, which is where we want teams to be or where we want our students to be, has both high psychological safety and high accountability. So when we think about what we want to teach teams how to work effectively, we think along those two. And so the practices I'm going to share are one from each of those two spaces. But we've all had the experiences of being on teams and having a horrible experience where people are free riding, either you're doing all the work or you just don't like the environment. And so since we all know what a bad team is, we can use that knowledge individually, regardless of what background you come from and what country, because we have a lot of international students. And for our course, it's a module. We actually have a lot of cross-registrants. We have a lot of people from the Graduate School of Education who take this class. We have a lot of people from the School of Public Health and from the Graduate School of Design who sign up for this module. So we really like for them to dig deep in their own personal experience when they start to think of some of the tools we use. So the first tool that we use for accountability, and when we say accountability, it's not accountability only to the task or the purpose of the class. And in this case, the students work with a client on a real world problem. And they're gonna, the intent of the course is to teach them our approach, but it's a learning by doing approach. It's a problem solving tool. And the only way you learn it is by doing it. And, but we don't want them to do it with some kind of abstract idea. And that's why we pair them with a client who actually has a real world problem and they're working on something that's very real. And some of the things that they may suggest will have a real impact. So it's accountability to the task itself and to the client. But more importantly, what Monica Higgins, who we work with, she teaches in one of our executive education programs, felt accountability, right? That is extremely important, accountability to each other on the team. So it's felt accountability that we're looking for. And what we use as a way to have that is a team constitution. It sounds really simple, but we find that it's really powerful. So day one, they have to sit in their team after we've randomly created the groups and allow them a few minutes to trade if they want to. They have to come up with a team constitution that week. And that team constitution, we give them some guidelines. That team constitution needs to be the norms that they're gonna hold themselves accountable to. One, how are they gonna communicate with each other? Do they have a WhatsApp group, whatever. You figure out what works for you, but you need to figure out how you're gonna communicate with each other. Second, how often are you gonna meet? Where are you going to meet? And then sharing of responsibilities and roles. We encourage them not to have one person taking notes, rotate the role of note taking. So there are some sort of things that we share with them. How do you share your learning? Because they will separate and each person will do something, but then how do you bring it back to the team so that we all learned from what one person went out to do? So we have them think about all of these things. And most importantly, we encourage them to think about how they're going to hold themselves accountable. So if you're late to a meeting, what are you going to do? You know it's going to happen. If someone doesn't show up to your meeting, what are you going to do? Let's think about it day one. Before we even start doing any work, how are we going to all work together? And what are going to be the consequences? And we've done this pretty much. We do this in country teams that we work with, and we've brought it to the classroom. And we've got people, either the penalty being pay money and then they go out for drinks after, to giving them some, they have to bring snacks for everyone, to things like they have to sing a song or they have to do a dance. Like, you pick, and we tell them, you pick what it is you're gonna do to hold each other accountable, but you need to find mechanisms to hold each other accountable for not showing up and also not doing the work. And then we have them sign the team constitution. Not because that's gonna, you know, we can hold them accountable to them signing, but the actual physicality of signing something that you all agreed to is something you can hold them accountable. I wanna share an example. in one of the years that we were teaching this class, one group came to me and it was two female students. And they said that they felt really uncomfortable and they felt that the males on the team were treating them with a very genderized role of, no, you organize the meeting with our client and you do that. And can you help and can you talk to them? And I said, well, you have a team constitution. What did you sign up for? You know, and they said, yeah, you know, we said we're going to share roles and we're going to do this. And I'm like, didn't you say you're going to share, you know, who's setting up the meetings? And I encouraged them to go back to their team and use their constitution as a way to say, this is what we agreed. And I also encouraged them not to jump to the conclusion. Again, we work with international students. Norms and cultures are very different across. What we may read as something another person may not even realize they're doing. And I said, maybe what you're feeling isn't what they're intending. Have you shared with them, when you do this, this is how I feel? And they said, no, we haven't done that. So I encouraged them. I said, look, I will only step in if I need to step in. I want you to try first and go and see what happens. They went back. They had a really great conversation with each other. I never had to step in. And what that showed them is how they can use this tool to have accountability in their team and to be able to change behavior and to address behavior. The second thing we do on psychological safety is Matt came up with this. And I know that there were some questions, especially in the morning panel on online, how do you do this online? It actually came up in the online, because in 2020, we taught 2021, we taught the class online. Now you can see this class is all about teaming, et cetera. And one student in the session said, how do we build psychological safety if we're all on Zoom? And so Matt had this idea. He's like, I've got an idea, let's just try it out. And this is what we've done constantly. We do it all the time. And it's as simple as we ask again in week one, we have the teams offer an act of kindness. Really simple. Each member offers an act of kindness to another member. And it has to be, here's the kicker, non-monetary. We learned over time, because when it's monetary, I can buy cookies for you. I can buy you chocolate and that requires nothing, you know, whatever. And we say, you cannot pay for this. And what we have found is it really allows team members to connect on a human level, which is really where the psychological safety comes from, and to see each other as humans and find commonality, as opposed to see each other in other ways that we may think about. And we have been amazed at what people have come up with and how they've built stronger ties. We have them do this twice. And then the third time, we have them offer an act of kindness to themselves, because self-care is something that no one prioritizes.
Wow. That is profound. Thank you so much for sharing practices along both dimensions of accountability and psychological safety. I can see how that's such an important foundation. So people may have more questions, but we can come back to them. Carrie, secret sauce, 1 to 2 specific practices.
Two things that I'm thinking of. That's a hard act to follow, by the way. So I'm just going to go with my things that are nowhere near as profound as those. One is, I briefly mentioned how we pair the student teaming with faculty teams. So just want to describe a little bit more what we do there. There's a faculty member who's like a normal, like somebody like myself, my full-time job is on the faculty. And then there's a second co-instructor who is often a senior doctoral student, or we have a few alums who have expertise and have been out in the field for a while, come back and co-teach with us. One of the big reasons we do this is a course on evidence use, and we are pretty ecumenical about what we mean by that. This is not a randomized controlled trial class. This is a different forms of evidence have different affordances. There's different things they are useful for. You evaluate them using different criteria. And no one person has a lot of expertise in every one of the types of evidence. And so it is important to us to be able to demonstrate that through our teams. We try to pair people up. I'm a little more quantitative. So I have my partner last year was a qualitative. She's a historian, very wildly different from my policy analysis background. But it was great because we could do exactly what we want our students to do. And so just like, if you started to get stuck or weren't sure how to answer, we have a norm of phone a friend and calling in. So I could phone a friend to Zenzele and say, Zenzele, I don't really know, can you help explain this idea around research paradigms that I'm not so familiar with? Or I could call in and say, you know, Zenzele, I'm noticing people in class looked a little bit confused. Let me offer a different explanation. Things like that. And we do that a ton. And it shows students that no one person is the expert. We have to rely on each other. And I hope opens up some space for them to feel comfortable doing the same in their own teams. And that, so that's one thing we do that I think is kind of different and cool. Another small thing we do is after the first couple of days, we do warm calling on teams. And this is for that accountability piece. They know they're going to get called on, but it's not a surprise. We tell them tomorrow, teams 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9 we have a name for it. I don't remember what it is, but you're on the hot seat for next week and we call on them first. So it gives them a chance to prepare a little bit more if they're the kind of student who's nervous about speaking, and then they can choose who in their team speaks that day. But they know somebody, they're all accountable for having a response to our questions.
Wonderful. And I saw the calling in and phoning a friend in action when I observed Carrie and Zenzele, and it was powerful modeling of the teamwork of the teaching team itself. Jocelyn, one or two small things that make a big difference, your secret sauce?
Yeah, I was just thinking about the list that I had here, and I wanted to sort of zoom in on the fact that I can share more about is that the teaming process is a learning goal. So it's the goal of that students can activate agency rather than, and it goes through sort of like a self-facilitated process, as I mentioned before. So there is definitely some scaffolding that we do as an on-ramp in what we're calling fall one, which is the semester that we're in right now. And the class is in fall two, where we actually do the teaming in the class. The students start with some exercises around thinking about shared values. So beside the technical piece of that work, whether it's conducting a landscape analysis or the interviews and things like that, they're actually talking to each other about the values that they have, that they hold. And that adds to understanding of each other and who and how they form teams. And what we've found also is that letting them do this on their own, not in front of us, so it's not performative, but letting them have that time to be in the classroom, the instructors walk out, and we just say at the end of 45 minutes, we want three teams of three students, and there's this negotiation process. What we've learned is that, you know, everybody comes with some element of anxiety, but that through talking about it, we've also seen students pull away from what they felt like was their first choice after listening to their cohort mates and decide on moving to another project. So there is that sort of give and take within the cohort. And we can do this because it is a smaller group of students that we're working with. It would be interesting to be able to see what it looks like in a larger group. But just that, the idea of agency and modeling agency is something that I think that we've iterated towards. And then one other thing was just this idea of that we're going to make some mistakes as a teaching team. It's in that lifelong, to model lifelong learning as the instructors as well, that we're going to be vulnerable on our own, on the instructor side as well. We don't have it all together. We're learning as we go, and we're co-learning with you to make this work. So that's one of the pieces, and I feel like it's more or less successful.
Yes, boy, I really appreciate this idea of grounding, of everyone grounding themselves and collectively grounding in around values, and that vulnerability and constant learning itself is a value that you model in practice. Wow, okay, so we've had just an abundance, a cornucopia of great ideas and practices put on the table. Karina, I'm going to turn it over to you to facilitate open Q&A. Folks have been putting things in the chat. So where do you want to take us? I'll step back.
Absolutely. So there are some really great questions that happened in the chat. But the one thing I wanted to comment on is how wonderful all of the secret sauces that you, the panelists, shared, and how all of them were grounded in essentially being human and being human with each other or being human with yourself. And really that being the core of doing teamwork well in a class and learning how to be on a team. So to that note, Josh had a really, so this is actually a two-parter. A couple of people were building on Josh's questions. He was intrigued by the difference of approaches that you were all taking in building your teams. So Matt and Salima, you had said, you know, you committed to making them random teams because they're not important or so on and so forth. I'll let you speak to that. Versus Carrie's teams, which are intentionally mixed of students in different degree programs from different areas, so on and so forth. And this is a question for all of you on what your thoughts are in these different approaches in building teams, whether or not they make a difference. How do you decide what approach to take when you're building teams in your class?
Well, I'm happy to start because I think we heard a little bit from Matt already about why they do random. So let me tell you why we don't do random. The course, although it is not entirely a quantitative course, there is quantitative material in it. And we have a decent number of students who come in who feel anxious about that. And so it is important for us to be able to say, someone on your team has some prior background in this topic, right? So they can, we're able to say, we've purposely assigned you so that no team has no one who knows something about this. So that's why the quant background matters, or just comfort with the material in general. Another thing that I didn't mention is that the course all builds towards this grand challenge that has to do with improving literacy outcomes in grades 3 to 5 in Charlotte, Mecklenburg, which is in North Carolina. And about, I think, a third or 40% or something of our students are international, come from other countries, and don't have a lot of familiarity with US education. And so again, it is important for us to be able to say, every team has at least one person who knows something about the US context. And then the third dimension that is sort of important to us is that this is the foundational course. We are intentionally mixing across the 5 different degree programs, or the 4 this year degree programs that we offer. And it's a chance for them to meet students outside of the program that they're in. So that's why we do it. But I would love to hear why people don't do it. Maybe we are expending a whole lot of effort on something that we could do some other way.
So I'll give you a couple of quick answers about this. And I think the answer to my mind is listening to, you know, Carrie's explanation. I think there's a real reason why you don't want to be random with some teams and you want to be random with others. And I think if you have some kind of substantive kind of focal point or some kind of material that you're covering or something, and you do need some kind of knowledge or some kind of knowledge base that either gives people confidence or that gives them a greater ability to engage, I think you don't want to be random about that. What we find, however, in the field is that oftentimes we're working on problems that countries have had for ages, and the people who say that they have the knowledge have been the people who've been working on them for ages. So we kind of don't really want to say you have the knowledge. Like we're basically saying, no, intentionally, we need to bring a whole lot of different heads together, and we don't really know who those people are. So we want to kind of create a little bit of luck here. We want to generate some activity. And we don't want people to be kind of putting on their knowledge hats here. We want you to be coming with humility, etc. So we find that kind of randomizing is an interesting way almost to say to people, let's kind of be curious and open. We don't only randomize across, we randomize up and down. So our teams in countries have got senior people, junior people, etc. So we can get into that. But in class, we find very much we have people working on all sorts of topics. And we actually find that, you know, when part of it is our efforts to non-randomize and our efforts to select people and to put people into the right team at the beginning takes so long and creates such a mess, and people get so upset because they're not in their group and they're not in their whatever. So we just find it really easy to say, this is completely random. You're in your group, we've done the choice for you. And then we literally do give them like like 5 minutes, and we say, if you can go and choose some another group and you can convince somebody else there to leave the group and to change with you, then you can shift, but you have 5 minutes. That's it. And so part of it is just managing the classroom is, you know, and people would say, well, and then the students, they grumble, they're upset, right? And my experience after doing this for 20 years, they grumble regardless of what you do. So what you want to do really quickly is just get them into being in a team. And our focus is not so much on who's in which team. It's more on, now you're in a team, how are you going to do this? How are you going to work together? And the sooner you can get them into that space, the sooner they just get their mind off, you know, was I on the transport team or was I on the education team or was I on the whatever? And then they start to realize that that's not the point of any of it after all. So if we were trying to stream people onto those transportation, education, et cetera, we would work harder to stream them into that, what's your background, et cetera. That's not what we want them to learn. We want them to learn about being humble. We want them to learn about listening, et cetera, et cetera. And so we kind of focus less on kind of what team are you on and how do you engage with the team? And we get into that conversation really, really quickly, which is almost why we almost a little bit kind of flippant about this, right? We don't even go into a lot of conversation. It's just, you're in these teams, you have 5 minutes if you're not happy, and then we're going to get together and do the team constitution. And by the end of that first session, no one's asking what team am I in. They're talking about how they're going to work together. And that's where we want to get them to really quickly.
I would just add that it's really intentionality on what you're hoping to do with your class. And both, there is no right or wrong. It just depends on what it is you're trying to do. I think for us also, random works better because we're trying to teach them a process and there's no expertise. Like Carrie, your point makes a lot of sense. You need quant and totally, you don't want people not to, then you're just setting your teams to fail. No one is an expert on our teams and they work on countries they've never been to. They work on problems that they're never ever going to see. You know, an example of that is this spring when we taught the class, we had one a problem on pollution of the rivers in China. There was no Chinese person on that team and nobody's ever been there. And we're like, that's great. You know, you're all working on this problem. Nobody knows anything any better. And so random helps. It really helps us with that.
We have a team right now. I know we're talking a lot, but they're working on like witchcraft related issues in Papua New Guinea. So it's like, we don't have any experts on that.
Excellent. Jocelyn, I also want to invite you to share your thoughts on creating teams in your class as well.
Yeah, it's just an evolving learning experience where it used to be that students sort of within them in their own space ranked whatever they, that it was based on the project. And I think what our class has iterated forward into is that, as our colleagues on the panel said, it's less about the project and more about the process. And that's what we invite our students into, sort of lean into that learning process. And I think ours is not random. It is intentional that there is this a process of facilitating this work by themselves. And it is for them to then go and implement that in their leadership practice. Like how would that look like in the worlds where they will then lead and lead the formation of teams? And we introduce these by thinking about values first, as opposed to that technical work. So.
Wonderful. Thank you all for sharing that. I think in the end, there is, a lot of you have mentioned there is no right way to structure a team. You will have to think a lot about what the true goals you have for your students and what is an authentic and genuine representation of what their future work is going to look like, right? There are going to be some situations where you're pulling together experts and people are experts in different topics. And there are some where you don't know who you're going to be working with. And that's just kind of how life goes. So how can you make this experience a genuine experience for your students to get better at? Another question that I think builds on the previous question, which Catherine had put in the chat, which is, and she asked does the importance of who is working together decrease as you get to more mature and expert participants? And I think the question is asking, there are going to be differences in terms of student experiences in working on teams. And how do you think about that when they're all coming together, when that knowledge itself also might vary?
Let me answer really quickly, and I'm just aware I'm speaking a lot. I think that's a difficult question, because I think the question also I saw it was kind of related. Do the members, are they older? Actually, you know, yes and no. Sometimes we have older students, sometimes we have younger students. Sometimes the older students, their experiences of working teams have either been really limited, and they're very, very used to being very hierarchical, and that can be its own problem in a team. And sometimes they've also had many experiences in teams and they jaded or they've been damaged. And so you know, the idea of kind of like thinking, well, there's people who experienced in teams. Our experience is most people, their experience in teams is negative. So actually the older they are, the more there's kind of like there's a process of kind of engaging with them around, you know, what they've done before, which hasn't necessarily kind of set them up to do this very well. So I would say in our experience, we don't really kind of think like that. We just think whoever's there, we think people are, what we're trying to do is just get them to relate to each other. And we're trying to get them to think less organizationally and more just kind of, how do you relate to your family? How do you relate to your friends? Let's think about doing that in a team. And we think that we're trying to kind of bring them to those familiar places where they have these collegial or these relational interactions that work well, and get them to channel that rather than whatever they have in their organization or whatever.
Excellent. Thank you, Matt, for sharing.
One thing I might add on this is, in my experience, it is our younger, less experienced students who have a harder time managing when the team starts to be difficult. And so like the circumstance that Selena described with the women coming to her saying the men, our more experienced students will just handle that themselves. They won't come to me asking for help. And so that's one thing I always have to make sure to do is to like, no, you try it first, just like you guys did, so.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing. I'm not sure if we have time for one more question, but I'm going to do it anyway.
Absolutely. We've got till 11:50.
Okay, perfect. And this actually came through a private chat. And incidentally, this is the one question that we didn't ask as part of the panel, where people were asking, how do you tie this with assessments and grade when they're working together on teams? How do you separate that? How do you put that together? How do students react to it? Big question, save for last.
Yeah, I'll just chime in real quick. The class is pass fail, just like I think Carrie mentioned the class at the Ed School as well. So the focus is not on competing or getting grade or being performative necessarily, but it is attending to that process. So that's one thing that's also a relief to the teaching teams. How do you grade some of these dynamics, right? The other piece is just, you asked about assessments. I think there's a lot of self-work that we ask the students to do, and maybe we could talk about it as like intentional quote unquote balcony moments to think about sort of the work of Heifetz and his colleagues, sort of the getting into the dance floor, you're doing all this stuff in the weeds and the technical stuff, and then intentionally pulling them up. Especially this is through the J term, the January term that we have, and saying, what do you make sense? How do you make sense of yourself, but also how the team's doing? And as you enter what we call sort of that ecosystem and teaming with that organization. So again, sort of the idea of this, it's not for a grade, and there's a lot of sort of reflective work on balance with that technical work that they're doing.
I would say that for us, this is a struggle because the team stands and falls together. And there was a time several years ago, we tried to have the teams rate each other and like say who was helpful and who was not helpful, and then try to see if we could give the people who were rated lower, slightly lower grade. But honestly, it was too much of a hassle and caused too many problems and pissed everybody off. And that's not the essence of the objective of what it is that we're trying to do in this course. And I think what we've done, and it works well, is we have, and Matt alluded to the learning, the pedagogy of the learning, is they do an individual assignment first. and then they do a group assignment. So in a way, we have a very good sense on who's doing work and who's not, because we see the individual assignment before they do a group assignment. And this is our own way of ensuring that they're learning, because we want them to learn, as Matt was saying, individually first, and then in a group, and then take whatever they've done in their analysis outside to somebody else and get their viewpoint, all in the name of learning how to use our process, but also learning to test their own biases and groupthink and all of those kinds of things. That, you know, experience is the best way to learn these things. When they go talk to someone and have this conversation where they're shocked that someone had a different opinion, that's amazing, because that's huge learning that they can take away with them.
Yeah, and in our case, we don't, it was a pass-fail class, we don't grade teams. We do have a check-in about 40% of the way through the course, just really please let us know how things are going with your teammates. And this is, though, a piece of the formal model that we're using, team-based learning, that we haven't really implemented yet. And it's on our list for next year to think about what might be the right way in this context of this course. But I cannot say we have a solution at this point.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much for sharing all your thoughts with us. I have 50 other questions I have in my own head, but I also recognize there are two more minutes. And in service of, we want this to also be a workshop and session where you can, all the panelists here can reflect. So I want to take the last 2 minutes and invite all of you who have joined us today to put into the chat one takeaway or thoughts that you have established from hearing all of our wonderful participants share their experiences. And I invite you to put that into the chat, and we will use this as a way to reflect and close off our session. While you work on that in the chat, the one plug I wanted to give is the HILT Learning Design and Affinity Group is doing a session next week that is going to build on this. And it's going to be social in service of thinking about teamwork and collaboration as a social event. It's called Exploring Teamwork and Collaboration Learning. It is next week in the Cabot Science Library Center. On September 29th, 2022, 3 to 5 p.m. You can register here, tinyurl.com/HILT Learning Design. I'll put the link in the chat. There will be sweets and coffee if that is what will get you through the door. But if you can join us, it would be lovely, because we want to create an opportunity past this conference. There are so many things that I know we've all heard in the last 2 hours that we want to create a space for people to really think about how we can actually implement this in our classrooms and beyond.
Some great ideas coming up, great takeaways coming up in the chat. A lot of stuff really resonating with folks. And we'll be saving the chat, and if, you know, let us know, or let HILT know if you're interested to have that transcript for yourself. There's a lot of wisdom collectively surfacing here. Yeah, and Matt, earlier, thank you for elaborating on what some of the acts of kindness looked like. That was it's an intriguing idea that's landing for a lot of folks, and just having some of those concrete examples was helpful.
Yeah, and some of the kinds of things were also, I know Matt put some in there, but sharing their self-care practices, like someone shared their soundtrack of like music that they listened to that kept them calm. It was just, and we continue to do this, and it always amazes us the kinds of creativity and uniqueness that people come up with. And then how it touches another person. In one case, a student sent a member a poem, which brought that member to tears. Like, and they had no idea what was going on in their life, but it just allows that serendipity and that connection, which is so lacking in teams.
Yes. Yeah, just to say one thing about that, Allison, is we also do kind of a review in class on that. So we have people share, and we'll say to them, what did it feel like for you to do that act of kindness? And then we have the other person say, what did it feel like to receive it? We want that human element to be coming into the teams, and we want them across the teams to be sharing that as well. So it's not, there's kind of a pedagogical aspect to it, if you want, right? Is we want people to learn, especially at a place like Harvard, how to purposefully be kind to each other, how to receive the kindness, and then how to talk about it. And we found that that's kind of like a bit of a rare thing. So, you know, it's not just the act, it's also the reflection on it.
Yes, wonderful. Well, maybe on that note, we will bid everyone farewell and thank you all, especially our panelists, for everything that you've brought to this community and to everyone. And there will be another breakout group, I think in 15 minutes, is that right, HILT? I think that's when we hope you have a great day and enjoy other sessions. Thanks.
Thank you all.